Tonight, WRAL goes beyond the headlines and daily news stories to explore a very serious issue for our communities and our country. I'm Gerald Owens, and if it feels like every week you're hearing about another deadly shooting by police or another officer shot and killed in the line of duty, that's because that's how often it's happening. So far this year, police around the country have shot and killed 907 people. 24% were African American. And while that percentage may not seem like a lot, consider this. African Americans make up only 18% of the U.S. population. This has also been a deadly year for law enforcement. 62 officers have been shot to death in the line of duty. That's a 59% increase from last year. Behind these statistics are complex and emotional issues, which is why tonight we're having an unprecedented two-hour community conversation on TV, web, and social media. First, Black and Blue, a new WRAL documentary, will air commercial-free. Then this critical dialogue moves online with a town hall conversation about race and policing, which you can join using social media. You're about to hear from families who have lost loved ones and officers who put their lives on the line every day. We invite you to watch this documentary with an open mind and an open heart.
Lately, I've been looking a lot for the texting and driving, stop sign violations, a lot of moving violations, you know, that might cause traffic accidents.
If I know I'm doing everything right by law, why do I still feel nervous that this officer is behind me?
We initiate the traffic stop. We turn on the blue lights and siren.
When an officer put the blue lights on me, I feel afraid. I'm afraid. I don't know why he's pulling me over.
India 16 traffic stop. The first thing we do is we call it out to dispatch. We want to give out our location first. Appears to be one occupant.
I've already had someone on the phone. They probably already know the destination.
I'm scared every time I approach a vehicle. I'm scared every time I go to a call because you never know what's going to happen.
If an officer's walking up to my car afraid of me just as much as I'm afraid of them, it can't end well.
When I approach a vehicle, I keep my hands kind of like this, just kind of in the ready position.
I drop my window. I take the keys out of the ignition. I hold the keys in my left hand out the window while I hold my right hand up with my ID.
I have three young children at home. I want to get home every single day. That's my goal.
Once this officer is walking to my car, the only thing on my mind is making it home safe.
Shoot him.
September 20th, another scene that has happened way too often in recent years. The shooting of a black man by a law enforcement officer. This time, it's Keith Scott in Charlotte.
Keith! Don't you do it! Did you shoot him? Did you shoot him?
These kinds of shootings have happened in our area, too. Last month, a Durham police officer shot and killed Frank Clark during a struggle at McDougal Terrace.
A gun, which was not the property of the Durham Police Department, was located next to the body at the scene.
In September 2015, Durham police shot and killed a suicidal Levante Biggs.
We want the Durham Police Department and the officers that shot and killed my baby to be charged and held accountable.
In January of 2013, Fayetteville police officer Aaron Hunt shot and killed Nyjah Hagans.
He's no threat to you if he's running away.
And in February, Raleigh police officer D.C. Twitty shot and killed Akil Dankins.
My son was murdered by the police for no reason, and I need justice for this right here.
There was a warrant for Dankins' arrest for failing to appear in court on a drug charge.
He wasn't a murderer. He wasn't a child molester. He wasn't a pedophile. He wasn't a rapist.
Byrd says Twitty shouldn't have chased her son.
And some could ask the same question, why run?
He ran because he didn't want to go to jail that day.
The police report says Twitty shot Dinkins when Dinkins reached for a gun as they struggled.
I really don't think that that was the case. I think it's a cover-up. Black America knows that white people are treated much differently than we are. So, and that needs to be changed. Something has to be changed about that.
After an FBI investigation, the district attorney ruled Twitty fired in self-defense and should not be charged.
How satisfied are you that that was a justifiable shot?
I'm very satisfied. The facts lended themselves to the outcome, and the decisions were handed down.
Durham's district attorney reached the same decision in the shooting of Levante Biggs.
At the end of the day, your decision has to be based on fact and law, and I am confident that I've done that.
His parents say Biggs was distraught over a breakup with a girlfriend and was standing on his front porch, pointing a gun to his head. His mother called 911, then tried to talk him into putting the gun down.
I'm a mom seeing her child put a gun to his head, and I'm turning around and I'm seeing these cops pointing the guns at him, and I don't understand it.
Police tried to get Biggs to put down what turned out to be a pellet gun. He did several times, but he picked it back up.
All of a sudden you hear pop, 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 pop. That's when I saw him falling. And I'm like, okay, they just shot him. That's the image that I wake up with. That's the image that I have every day. I'm him lying on the ground. And I'm thinking, like, this was a suicide call.
Oh, we was heartbroken. That's our baby. 5 shots hit him. A lot of other shots went into the house where people were still in.
That's not justifiable.
Police say they fired when Biggs pointed the gun at them.
I can't believe that until someone shows me video otherwise.
We don't trust the police.
And it's very hard for me to sit here and say that if he was a different race in a different neighborhood, that he would be dead.
When Officer Hunt stopped Nyjah Hagans in Fayetteville, there was a confrontation. Hagans slammed the car door into Officer Hunt and ran. As Hunt shot at him, hitting him 4 times. Twice in the back.
He knew that Mr. Hagans had a gun, and the only person when that dynamic began to occur, the only person that had a gun in their hand was Mr. Hagans.
After an FBI investigation, the district attorney said the officer fired in self-defense and should not be charged. But the Fayetteville NAACP says there is no reason to shoot a fleeing suspect.
It is time for police officers to realize you just can't shoot and treat black people differently than white people.
Compounding community tensions were accusations of racial profiling by Fayetteville police in 2011. And a 2014 UNC study showed racial disparities in traffic stops statewide.
The study found black drivers were 75% more likely to have their vehicles searched than white drivers, even though they were less likely to have illegal contraband.
Young black and brown men in North Carolina, just like in other parts of the country, are facing a pattern of being subjected to policing behaviors that the rest of us can't understand or relate to because it's never happened to us.
Umar Muhammad, a community organizer for the Southern Coalition for Social Justice, says those behaviors have led to deep fear and mistrust of police by many African Americans.
Poor black communities are being raised as lower your head when you speak to the police, or don't raise your voice and don't move your hands. If possible, don't answer the door.
It's part of what many African Americans call the talk. Muhammad says his mother gave him the talk as a child.
My mother always used to say, you're born with 2 strikes. You're black and you're male. Do not come in contact with law enforcement. Avoid police at all costs. Don't conversate with them because they'll trick you. You'll say something and they'll use it against you.
The recent spate of police shootings of black men have exposed those underlying attitudes and the emotions behind them.
These incidents happen all the time. I think that the nation is just now becoming aware of it.
Thanks to social media and 24-hour television news.
No justice!
Cops have screwed up.
Next, some candid conversations with cops.
What do you think? Pretty cool, huh?
And efforts by three local police departments to ease tensions and build relationships.
We have changed the way we do business.
The talk Umar had with his mother is for many in the African American community a rite of passage, a serious conversation parents have with their kids about what to do if stopped by the police. After a recent spate of police shootings, many of them captured on camera, a new sense of urgency has surfaced in this conversation. One church created a 10-step video on what to do if stopped by police for parents. We showed that video to parents here at Capital Broadcasting Company.
10 rules.
10 rules.
10 rules.
10 rules of survival.
10 rules of survival if stopped by the police.
Number one, be polite and respectful when stopped by the police.
Be polite.
Be respectful.
Remember that your goal is to get home safely.
Your goal is to get home safely.
Your goal is to get home safely. I'm sorry.
Powerful message.
Don't go to the glove compartment. You know, make sure you're respectful. Wait till they ask you for your registration and license.
Roll your window down. That's the first thing you want to do. You don't want them to walk up on you and have to bang on the glass because that makes you a little nervous.
My mom's Caucasian, my dad's African American. And so growing up on my mom's side, we never really had the talk. And then I learned quickly at 16 years old, like, don't drive too fast because I pulled over, you know, speeding ticket here and there, whatever. Then I noticed it kept being a constant thing. It's like probably like 10 times get pulled over, and sometimes they have a reason and sometimes they don't.
No, it's not fair, but you know, life's not fair. And you know, it's something that has to be brought to their attention, you know.
Because someone could interpret his presence, his voice, his dress as a threat at any time. Of course it's not fair, but it's the way the world is and it's not improving. So every day I worry.
Join the discussion after this documentary on WRAL.com. There you'll find a town hall event on race and policing.
City Indy 16 traffic stop.
For Fayetteville Police Officer Sarah Hansen, a routine traffic stop is another opportunity to practice community policing.
You got your license and your registration, ma'am? I won't keep you long. How old's your baby?
7 months.
Aw.
Hansen gives the driver a warning ticket for running a stop sign.
Hey, big guy. Hey, sweetheart. I got this guy for you, and I got a little police car, okay?
And she gives the driver's son a couple of toys.
You're welcome, buddy. Can I get a fist bump? Thanks, bud. You take care of your mom, okay?
Hansen says she's trying to turn the negative experience of getting stopped into a positive interaction with police, especially when children are involved.
You want to go sit in the car and want to see my lights? A lot of children see their mom or their dad being taken away from their homes by police officers because they've done something wrong. No, you don't need to sit in the back. Sit right there. And so they have such a negative idea of police officers from a very early age. What do you think? Pretty cool, huh? What really drives me bonkers is when people tell their children, you know, oh, there's the cops. You want me to tell them to take you down to jail? You know, no. And I correct them, you know, and I say, hey, you know, sweetie, come here, to the child. And I say, hey, when you see one of us, we're good and we can help protect you. And if you ever need anything and you see one of us, come to us. Let us help you. Can I have a hug?
That's part of Hansen's philosophy of community policing.
We are highlighting the work being done in Fayetteville around police procedure and policy.
In May, Attorney General Loretta Lynch visited Fayetteville to recognize the department's community policing effort.
Community policing is not a program, not in my mind, it's a philosophy. It's the way we do business. It's what we believe in.
Medlock helped address the racial profiling issue by telling his officers to only stop people for moving violations instead of things like expired tags or cracked windshields.
We shouldn't be doing traffic stops or making stops of motorists to try to search their car. We stop that. The purpose of a traffic stop is to make our streets safer.
We appreciate the job you do for us.
Yes, ma'am, it's my honor.
Vehicle searches, use of force, and citizen complaints are all down, while citizen compliments are up.
You have blessed day.
You as well, ma'am.
Safe.
Thank you so much.
Those are the things that start to tell you that the relationship that we have is improving, it's working, and the community policing philosophy is not just taking hold in the department, but it's taking hold across our community, and folks are buying into the philosophy.
I think that the community needs to realize that we're not here to hurt you. We are here to help you. And, you know, we need your support. We need your backing.
I look forward to putting this uniform on every single day.
And Sergeant Dale Gunter says every single day, patrolling Durham involves community policing.
You're a smart guy.
From discouraging a panhandler.
They do mind when you're out there asking their customers for money.
That's, to lending that's some kids money for an icy.
How much is an icy?
$1.
$1 a piece?
Yeah, to get two, it's $1.
Let me see if I got $1. Yeah. A lot of these neighborhoods, kids don't get a whole lot. They see more negative things happening with the police than necessarily positive.
Here's the deal. Next time, you got to buy me one.
So we make sure we stop and take some time to talk to them.
Two ice creams.
Most important tool I have is my ability to speak to someone, my mouth.
You look like you've had a little bit to drink. So are you done drinking for today?
And using it to get to know people in the community.
They should be able to trust me like I should be able to trust them. Okay? And it means a lot to a citizen or anybody if you can talk with a police officer and have a down-to-earth conversation with them.
Okay, all right.
But Gunter says trust can be hard to earn.
A lot of citizens don't trust us. It's just a fact of life.
Gunter says police deserve some of the blame.
Cops have screwed up. When you hire human beings, you're going to have people that make mistakes. And then you've had a few that are just outright breaking the law. Over 22 years as a cop, I've seen a lot of officers go away that needed to go away.
But he says the vast majority of police officers are honest and want to do good work. He says many just need to communicate better.
Police can talk to citizens a whole lot more, no matter their color. We'll go over there and take a look, see what we see.
No, thank you so much.
I appreciate it, guy. See you.
He also says citizens have a responsibility to comply with an officer's commands.
There's one phrase that works for me is comply now, complain later. Last thing I want to do is fight with anybody. The last thing I want to do is tase anybody and, God forbid, have to shoot anybody. We don't want to see anybody hurt. Last thing we want.
Community policing to me is more than having a chief that believes in the philosophy. It means to change the culture. It means that every officer in the department has a role in bridging that gap with the community and establishing positive relationships.
Davis says one of the keys to that is people in the community and police officers recognizing their own implicit biases.
Even though I may have a bias about a particular group, if I'm aware of it, then I can manage my interactions a whole lot better. We might not be able to ever change the way we feel about people that don't look like us. But as police officers, we can still be professional and respectful.
See you, Heather.
Raleigh police officers hang out with some kids in a southeast Raleigh neighborhood. They say it's to try and show their human side.
And I think at a certain point, I kind of think we're robots. That's all we do is just we're police 24 hours a day. And this gets to show them the other side.
Getting your homework done, making great, making good grades, listening to teachers.
Raleigh has done this kind of community policing for more than 20 years. It includes youth sports and other mentoring programs to try and build relationships.
It's no different than any other relationship. It's all about communication. And, you know, it's no different when you're home interacting with your family. There's a lack of communication. Things go bad.
Raleigh's police chief says she is committed to communication. In December of 2015, she held a series of what were called face-to-face meetings with a range of community leaders to talk about transparency, accountability, diversity, and other issues.
That's a huge relationship building initiative that we took on here.
You see situations where the officer is escalating the circumstances that lead to someone getting hurt.
More recently, the chief held public forums at barbershops to hear community concerns.
We have a problem. It's a community problem. It's a universal problem.
community policing is not just a title or a phrase. It's got to be shown through actions. It's got to be shown through partnership and relationships and having that dialogue, but not just talking the talk, but walking the walk.
In the face-to-face meetings and barbershop forums, the chief says she has a key question in mind.
How do we get to a point where there is an understanding and a respect for each other and the roles that law enforcement have, but also for the greater community, regardless of the color of a person's skin?
Raleigh didn't see the kind of rioting after the Akil Denkin shooting in February that Charlotte saw after the Keith Scott shooting in September. The chief says it shows two decades of community policing is paying off.
Our citizens marched, they protested, but our city was not destroyed in the process.
What do we want?
Justice!
When do we want it?
Now!
Next, despite community policing efforts, there is still a need to heal.
There is no trust, no trust at all.
In the last segment, you heard the term implicit bias. You may have heard that term before and wondered, what does it mean? Well, I sat down with Dr. Benjamin Reese of Duke University to learn more. He researches implicit bias and how it affects our behavior, and he trains security officials and law enforcement on it.
Well, if you think of explicit bias being the bias that we're aware of, we know what we're saying, we know who we're saying it to, we often know its impact. Implicit bias is believed to be unconscious, or at least out of our awareness.
From birth, Dr. Reese says we're surrounded by images and information that form our ideas of people. What we see on television, read, and see on the internet, and our cultural backgrounds inform our unconscious mind. That's how negative, often harmful stereotypes and associations also form. Harvard developed the Implicit Association Test. It helps people discover their implicit biases. Data from the test reveals how many whites perceive blacks on this unconscious level.
The test, for a great majority of people, shows that the connections that we have between blackness and things negative tend to be stronger than the kinds of associations we make between blackness and things more positive. And so that occurs on an unconscious level. And so we believe that that has some connection with the kinds of behaviors that we then exhibit. Making those kinds of associations in seconds, in milliseconds.
That looks like a bad dude too.
This is what implicit bias looks like. A Tulsa police officer made that comment without knowing anything about the man except what he looked like from a helicopter. Moments later, a different officer shot and killed the man. She is charged with manslaughter. Dr. Reese says in stressful situations, when you have to quickly make a decision, positions officers are often in, implicit biases influence our actions. And it works both ways. Some communities have unconscious biases toward police.
You see enough interactions between police and black communities in your neighborhood. You see questionable shootings on TV. And so you'll find people begin to generalize about policing in general. So it works both ways.
In Dr. Reese's workshops, he doesn't attack participants or label them. Instead, he teaches them to be more aware of their thoughts and reflect on why they think the way they do. He also challenges them to talk to someone unlike them. So what are your implicit biases? Head to our website, WRAL.com, and take the Harvard Implicit Bias Test. That's also where you'll find the town hall on race and policing.
This WRAL documentary is available on demand on all of these platforms. For exclusive bonus video and interviews from tonight's program, go to WRALDocumentary.com and talk to us by following WRAL Doc on Facebook and Twitter.
You haven't acknowledged that we deserve more than minor tweaks to a systemic problem.
Akil Denkin's mother has turned into an activist. She speaks at Raleigh City Council meetings to demand more police accountability.
Prove accountability. Hold these policemen accountable for their actions.
Black people, black men in particular, want to be respected.
She's also critical of the city's community policing efforts.
I don't think they're working at all. They might try to put themselves in a community meeting, but that's all. It's all for show.
Some activists also say there needs to be more equity in how policing occurs in different neighborhoods.
It's not a color issue, it's a cultural issue. And I think that the culture within the department has to be one that says, this is the standard, and no matter what side of town, whether you're in 27610 or 27614, that we're gonna police with the same mentality.
I want to know why the police filled my baby body with bullets.
The parents of Levante Biggs say the same thing needs to happen in Durham.
When they police in our neighborhoods, it's different. It's a little more hostile. We just want to be treated like everybody else want to be treated.
We're not against police. We're against the actions that you make that are not the same actions that you would make with another race.
Like Akil Denkin's mother, Biggs wants more police accountability.
There's a problem, and you can't even admit it. But when we say something, we're wrong. No, there's a problem. Not with the whole police force, but there's a problem somewhere, and you need to at least start admitting that you have a problem. And talk to the community people out there, the leaders out there, and figure out what can you do to make it better.
In addition to more accountability, citizen activists want more transparency. From police getting information out to the public more quickly, to all of them wearing body cameras.
It's the police! Who do you think it is? Because you hit her!
And many say police need more training in cultural sensitivity and in de-escalating confrontations verbally, with force being used as a last resort instead of a first instinct.
Listen, I'm Officer Hanson with the Fayetteville Police Department, all right? Badge 465, what can we do for you?
But it's not just up to our police to solve the problem.
No amount of community policing can solve the underlying problems of poverty and income inequality, and a shortage of social services to treat things like addiction and mental illness.
They killed my son, because he ran.
And some say the communities at odds with police have a responsibility to ease tensions too.
How we can make sure that we don't take situations and we don't escalate them, as we can continue to engage with each other. You know, we make sure that we do our parts as citizens.
I believe that dialogue can happen, but I also believe that it has to be on the terms of the community. I believe the community would be willing to speak if some plain clothes officers with no gun, no badge, came as humans to speak to other humans.
This is a very defining moment.
There has to be an understanding on both sides.
It's time for a change. It's time for a change. It's time for all of us to get together.
But we have to look towards reconciliation and moving forward, because ultimately this is our community and this is our city.
This is just the beginning of our commitment to exploring and discussing these issues of race and policing. Right now on WRALDocumentary.com, there is a lot of bonus content. You can watch extended interviews with the police chiefs and find links to resources such as an implicit bias test. This test helps reveal the biases you may not even realize you have. And in about 4 minutes, you can watch a town hall discussion about race and policing. A diverse panel of people directly affected by these issues share their experiences, concerns, and hopes for the future. As you watch, join the conversation on social media by using the hashtag BlackAndBlueNC. We at WRAL will be part of this critical conversation, along with experts and leaders from around the area. Again, that special online event begins in 4 minutes. We'll see you then.
Beyond Black and Blue, this special community conversation continues with your moderator, True Pettigrew.
I tell you, I don't know if it's because I'm getting older or maybe because I'm a Scorpio, but I get real emotional. I've been doing this for the last 3 years, as you just mentioned, and you know, I watched that film. This is my third time seeing that documentary. And I still get emotional when I watch it. I started doing this work for a reason, and guys, and just bear with me for a second, like, I want to see change so bad that it hurts. It really does. And it's that pain and that hurt that I I do my best not allow that hurt to transition into hate sometimes, quite candidly, right? And so tonight is very important to me that we focus on solutions. I think everyone in here recognizes and realizes that there is a problem. So we want to focus on solutions. How can we leverage these beautiful minds, and as well as the hearts and minds of all of you, to come together to figure out how can we provide some resolution and reconciliation and really begin healing. So I'll just, first of all, thank each and every one of you. Thank the panelists for being here. Thank all of you for coming here tonight. And I also want to say a special thank you to Ms. Bird, Akil Dinkins' mom, who is here tonight. And I just want to thank you and acknowledge your courage and your confidence and your comfort for being willing to be here and participating in this documentary as well. So I will share a couple of things I want to share with the panelists. I know some of you, I don't know all of you, but if you could limit your responses to 2 minutes when I ask you a question, limit your responses. I know for some of the folks in certain industries, certain industries, I know that's a little more challenging for some of us than others. And see, and we're here to talk about breaking down stereotypes, right? See, look at me. I'll put a dollar in the jar later. If you could limit your responses to 2 minutes when, you know, your aunt's asking a question. And please, I encourage you all to start thinking about your questions, texting in your questions for all of our baby boomers. You can write your questions down. That's cool. All right. No, I'm just kidding. But each of you, just take a second to introduce yourselves to everyone and just let everyone know who you are and exactly what you do and what brought you here tonight. And we'll start with you, Dr. Harshaw.
My name is Dumar Harshaw. I serve as senior pastor of First Baptist Church in the capital city of Raleigh, also chairman of the Triangle Martin Luther King Committee. And what brought me here is my deep concern about what is happening in our society as well as our communities, and the ongoing pain that we revisit tonight of life being taken that appears to be unnecessary in those encounters. And lived through this through decades, through my work as a pastor, also in Los Angeles, California, and not much has changed over those decades. It's only gotten worse. And I came here because I think now there seems to be a readiness to provide some kind of bridge to a common struggle to really change what has been happening, and also to talk about some of the underlying issues that we tend to push aside that this country has to deal with if there's going to be any solution.
Thank you. Kate?
Hi, my name is Kate Dieter Meriday, and I'm an attorney and a mediator in Raleigh. I have three kids, a biological son, and then I have two little girls who are African American, and that my family adopted them. And this summer we had a block party in our neighborhood, and we had some police that were there doing some community outreach. And it was right after the Dallas sniper shooting. And as I was standing there with my five-year-old daughter, who loves the police and says she wants to be a police and often mm-hmm. salutes the police, and she's very, when we go through TSA at the airport, she always tells them she wears her bike helmet and wears her seatbelt and recounts all the good things that she's doing. So I was standing with her for a long period of time while she was in the police officer's car. And a number of folks came up to the police officer and they were thanking that individual for his service. And then some of them were making some that were derogatory with regard to the Black Lives Matter movement. And so I felt that it was necessary to engage in a dialogue at that block party, and it became the catalyst for a project I've been working on for about 6 months, and True and I are partnering on, bringing together members of the African American advocacy community and law enforcement, and facilitating a dialogue, not a town hall forum, but a specific type of dialogue. And We're partnering with a nonprofit in Boston, and they flew down recently and trained a bunch of us to facilitate this dialogue. So I have a number of different perspectives, and I'm happy to be here. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Kate. Candace.
All right, so 2 minutes isn't going to be hard for me because I'm like hearing a producer in my head saying 30 seconds. my name is Candace Sweat. I'm a reporter at WRAL News. You probably typically see me at 10 on Fox 50 or 11 o'clock on WRAL. But I'm here to give my perspective as a journalist, as a reporter. But a lot of you all probably don't know that I'm also the daughter of a police officer in Dallas. So also here to share that perspective as well and some of the, personal conversations that my mother and myself have had over the last several months, certainly the last several years, but for sure over the last several months, so.
Thank you, Marcus.
All right. Hey, everyone. I am Marcus Ziegler. I'm a recent graduate of NC State, so I'm kind of young on the panel. But but I'm here because after graduation, I am on the process of creating my own nonprofit and to build the community and police relations. So that's why I'm up here. I'm just trying to spearhead the change I want to see in the community.
Yep. Thank you, Marcus. Slow.
My name is Winslow Thornton. I'm a loan officer, senior loan officer with once upon a time Gateway Bank, is now Cornerstone Home Lending. I'm a business partner with True Pettigrew. I've been on this journey with him from day one. I can still remember when we sat in my office and discussed the potential and the possibilities for expanding rap sessions. So it's been a privilege and an honor to see him grow, develop, and watch God use him the way that he has. In conjunction with the barbershop rap sessions, I conduct our in-home version of rap sessions. I have a rap session at my house every third Saturday. Any guy, any of the fellas, unfortunately, ladies, we haven't gotten that far just yet. We'll get there soon, I assure you. Been trying to get Miss Tamika Pettigrew to take over that part of our operation. But the home version, it's very intimate. It's very quaint. The invitation is to any man. My home is open to you. I do provide some vittles. And JB enjoyed the butter beans last time he was there. I engage the community via football. I am a semi-pro football coach. I'm also the commissioner for the Southeastern Football League. Several hundred young men under my authority. And we try to help them bridge the gap between whether or not they want to get into college football, the Canadian Football League, overseas. We try to help them live their dreams, and that's my input into the community. And I'm honored to be here.
Thanks, Slo. JB.
I'm JB. I'm an 18-year veteran of the Cary Police Department. I am the officer that True met when he walked into the police department, so I think that's why I'm here. I also think I'm here because it hurts me that people see me and have fear. That's a piece when I joined this profession and I believe in this profession that hurts me to my core. And if I can do anything to keep that from happening ever again, I want to be a part of it. So thank you for having me.
Thank you all. Thank you. So, Slo, I'll start with you. You know, we all saw you, the guy in the yellow shirt, if you guys don't recognize him, in the barbershop form in the documentary. You were very emphatic about saying there is a problem. There is a problem. Can you elaborate? And I think we all know there is a problem. I want to hear from you to articulate what you believe that problem is.
And I think a part of the problem is that white America is just now catching up. I think that's the greater issue. You know, in the black community, it's no secret that we've been getting our tails whipped. I didn't cuss. We've been getting our tails whipped for quite some time, several hundreds of years. So this is nothing new for us. This is nothing new to us. It's new to the white community. And that's because they haven't had the same exposure that we've had. And because you haven't had the same exposure, you don't have the same experience. Because you don't have the same experience, you're not familiar with my environment, my responses and my reactions are going to be quite different from yours. And so you're trying to understand why it is that I respond and I react the way that I do. But you can't understand that until you've exposed yourself to my environment and my surroundings. And I think that's where it all begins. I think that's where it starts. I think that's the manifestation of the problem in and of itself. There's levels and layers that I could probably go into a lot further, but I think that's ultimately where it begins. The ability to familiarize yourself with my world. We live in the same community, we live in the same world, but we don't necessarily have the same experiences because you're not in my environment. And therein lies the greater challenge.
Thanks, Slo. Now, Dr. Harshaw, you're over here nodding, and I hear you kind of affirming a lot of the things that you're hearing. And even in your introduction, you mentioned that you've been seeing this for a lot of years.
Mm-hmm.
Can you elaborate? I mean, it sounds like you're referring to what Winslow was talking about
exactly.
when you said you've been seeing this for a lot of years.
Yeah, right. The disparity of the policing in the African-American community, it's related to racism. And now I think with what is happening in the 21st century now, we have an opportunity to really deal with it straight on. And I agree with you that what we've been living through, a lot of people have winked at or never acknowledged. And so it seems like it's new, but it's not new. And working in the communities across the decades, I mean, there were police shootings all the time that never made the media. And just like people killed in prison and you never even hear about it. But now is the time to begin to really deal with the underlying problem. And it's so deeply entrenched in American society. It's racism. I mean, that's part of it. There are systems of injustice. You know, we deal with economics and equity and all these issues. But until those things are talked about and dealt with and wrestled with, it doesn't mean you have to become black to police a black community. But you have to understand that you need a new orientation because there's a history that we so often don't acknowledge. And this history of racism in the United States of America. We see it now displayed in so many other places. And a lot of people today are surprised, but it's just that now it's being exposed. So the beauty of that is that now, perhaps in an honest way, we can attack it, deal with it, talk about it, and it will be painful. And it is long range, it's not gonna be solved overnight, but that's the only way that we're gonna get at any kind of thing that looks like a solution.
Thank you. So JB, as the lone officer up on this panel, what are your thoughts about what you're hearing right now about the issue, really, the underlying issue really being racism and being race? And I think did that come out to you in what you even saw in this documentary that you know, viewing this through the lens of an officer, did you see the racial undertones and issues that was that conveyed to you through this documentary?
Sure, and I think that's what going to a man whose house I don't look like Slo. I don't know if that comes across on TV or not.
You'd never be this sexy.
Right, I understand. True did call us beautiful, just so you know. And so the fact that I don't look like Slo, but I can sit down at his dinner table and eat his food and have a conversation. That matters. And what I realize is he eats the same way I do.
Was that a lot?
Right, a whole lot. But it's real good, so I understand why. But that video, that documentary started out talking about the fear that the officer had during a traffic stop. And then the citizen had that same fear. And I've said this before, I don't know how different we are. Those are fears. Now the difference comes in when Slo talks to his son, when he has the talk with Trey, it ends potentially with Trey dying. The difference is when I have that talk with my sons, it doesn't end that way. That's not right. That's not how it should be, but that's how it is. And so when I talk to my children, if they mess up on that traffic stop, they go to jail. And so I think that's what When Slo talks about white America, that's our responsibility. We have to deal with that. He's not saying me personally. He's not saying JB did anything. He's not pointing out any one of those officers that are here tonight did something specifically. This is a greater piece. And now individually I can impact that. Individually I can be different. But the reality is Slo and I have the same wants and desires. America just hasn't allowed that to happen.
Okay. Marcus, young black male, and we've been hearing that how that has been the target of these issues that we're talking about tonight. mm-hmm. being a young black male, right. one of the two millennials on the panel, right? Are you, y'all can figure out who the other one is. Yeah. I heard the young man say that, you know, when he sees the police, he gets afraid. And I heard a lot of different emotions articulated in this documentary. Fear, anger, hate, mistrust. Are any of those applicable to you when it comes to law enforcement?
I would definitely say fear. Because, I mean, as a young black male, we are normally the ones targeted, or as it seems, we are the ones targeted. But I kind of come with a different perspective, because when I was at NC State, I had relationships with police officers, white, black, and they were all good. I mean, they weren't bad. So, but I also have had those interactions of driving while black and other interactions. So I've had it from both sides. So for me, it's kind of a hit and miss. It's like, man, I know it's there and I understand it's there. And at the same time, I do know there are good cops, and I know there are officers that want to talk to you, they want to get to know you, and they want to actually care. So it's just a point of getting an understanding from not just the community, but for the police officers, so that we can come together and really understand what is really going on. So to answer your question, yes and no, I guess. Yeah.
Yeah, but you do feel fear of enforcement.
Yeah, definitely.
Which is not where we should be.
Right.
Law enforcement should be here to protect and serve.
Right.
And not instill fear in the hearts of the the community that they're protecting and serving. Kate, I know I'm very familiar with the work that you're doing, and you talked about your two children, your two biracial children, which is what gave you a reality of what's really going on, because it's now at your doorstep. Mm. Right. Mm-hmm. Prior to that, were you aware of, or even did you have any level of sensitivity to these types of issues, even prior to what you experienced at the block party?
Absolutely. Yes. Yes. This. I mean, adopting my children did not educate me in that moment about every. You know, I've practiced, before I became a mediator, I practiced as a trial litigator for about 10 years in North Carolina, and all in jurisdictions all over the state. And often when you go to outside of Wake County into a rural place, you see the folks that are white and or dressed nicely walking around the metal detector to go into the courtroom, and folks of any brown-skinned person often is pulled aside. Those are some of the things that I would notice. You know, I was certainly aware of the problems that exist. I just have a different perspective now, that it's my own children, and I have a fear when I hear people talking about the talk. I don't know how to do that with my girls, and I want all three of my children. I say I have, Nora's five, I have 10 years until she's driving. And I want her to be able to wear a hoodie and play music and maybe go through a stop sign and survive a traffic stop. And there's lots of work to be done. And I'm taking this opportunity to educate myself as much as I can, but also you and I talk about how we give each other credibility in different groups, and I think it's so important for, this is not a black issue, this is not a white issue, this is an issue for all people. Yeah. And I think it's so critical for people to come together. You know, walking on the street, someone might not know what my children look like or what my perspectives are, and I think we all need to do what we can to come together and learn and share each other's perspectives.
Do you get pushback, or have you received pushback? You know, we talked about the lending each other credibility. Do you get this notion of you projecting yourself as the great white hope?
Sure.
As this, you know, this white woman coming in to save the day for all the black children of America. And so you get pushback and resistance in that way.
Well, first of all, I want to say that's definitely not my intention in terms of how you were characterizing it. But yes, yes. So the project that I'm working on, that you're participating on, and some others in the room I see here today who are helping with the project as well, we want to bring together 9 law enforcement folks and 9 African-American community advocates, and we're doing this very specific type of facilitated dialogue. And we're working with this group from Boston, and they bring together pro-choice and pro-life people, or Second Amendment and gun control folks, and they have had a lot of success having these types of conversations and building relationships across the divide. So for me to get participants for the program, I've called lots and lots and lots of people.
Got a lot of no's.
And I've gotten a lot. it just takes a lot of folks to make something worthwhile. And
what do you say to the people who look at you as just being just surface and just doing it for the props or to feel good so you can alleviate your white guilt, so to speak?
Well, I think anyone that knows me knows that's not me. So and hopefully what typically happens is when I get into a conversation with someone and I'm being honest and I'm talking about where I'm coming from and I'm honest about what I need to learn and where I need to go, I am certainly not suggesting that I have all the answers to solve this problem at all. I professionally, I sit down with people every day who there's accusations flying at mediations and they're coming into a room. Sometimes there's a death, sometimes there's a horrible accident, and we sit down at a table and we talk, and at the end of the day, often they're signing an agreement all together. And so that professional experience has inspired me to try to see if we can bring it here. But no, I had a gentleman that I contacted, and I've been calling people, and someone will say, well, contact this person or that one, and it sort of leads like a spider web to all different. Well, I'm not cold calling people to participate in the project, but I did. I had an interaction with the gentleman, and he said straight up, why do you think you have the answer? Why do you think, shouldn't it be coming from the black communities, and why do you think you're? And I said, sir, I don't think I have the answers. I'm trying to do my small part, and I'm hoping that it'll make a difference, and I'd love for you to participate and bring what your experience has been, which is very different from mine. But maybe we can work together. And so, but I would say there's an appetite for this type of conversation, particularly in this area, and that makes me happy.
So Candace, based on what we just heard Kate talk about, and she referenced the talk, right? And being the daughter of a police officer, how does that work in your home? Does the talk exist with your mom?
It does.
From your mom?
It does. I think of instances where, I have to call and say, Mom, I got pulled over by the police. And immediately she's, well, how were they? Were they nice? Were they a word that she uses? And so she knows. And she knows that, the little decal on my front, front right part of my car or the back of my car, it may or may not make a difference, and in the way that I'm treated. And so, even as the daughter of a police officer, the talk does exist. And she is often concerned, always concerned about, how I'm treated when I'm pulled over by her colleagues, essentially.
Okay. Now, we have a lot of people on this panel that represent a lot of different industries. And so I want to really focus the conversation on, we're going to take some questions from the audience right now, but I really want to take this conversation in the direction of what are some things that we can do to help? We've heard what the problem is. There's a lot of different issues, right? What is law enforcement doing and what can law enforcement continue to do? What can community leaders do, right? What can we do from a higher education standpoint, right? What can be done from a media standpoint? What can parents do? What can the faith-based community do? How can we come together to start really providing solutions? And I think about, even as we're doing this tonight, I think about President Obama's task force on 21st century policing and how that was really, I think this is essentially a microcosm of what they were doing, bringing different people with different leadership mindsets from different institutions together to understand how each of those different institutions can contribute to the solution. And also really be honest with ourselves and think about wow, how may I possibly be contributing to the problem as well? All right. So I want you guys to kind of think about that as we start taking some questions from the audience.
Yes, we have quite a few questions now, so thank you all for texting. And also, if you have a note card and you wanted them to pick it up, just hold it up, and these lovely ladies in the corner will grab it for you. Here's one question for Officer JB. How do we navigate the campaign of police being here to, quote, protect and serve, which implies working alongside at the will of the people, when in fact there is a very real power dynamic involved, one which allows an officer to say, quote, comply now, complain later? These feel like opposing goals.
Yeah, I don't think they're opposing. I think what I want is to live through a traffic stop, and I think Slow wants to live through a traffic stop. That's why I say we're not that different. What I think is important is for police departments all across the country to ask, okay, community, what do you need from me? How can I help you? Because again, I'm a white guy. I have to ask the African-American community what you need, because I'm still a white guy. And when we did that, we got very specific answers from our community. The community that we serve said, these are the things you need to do. And so it's not necessarily about comply, that's a piece. It's about all the other relationship building that goes on. I want to know you before an event ever occurs. That's my goal. And if I can do that, if I can get to know who you are, and you can get to know the person outside of this uniform, then we are already in a better situation when an event does happen.
So just elaborate on that real quick, JB. And I think that's awesome, and that is ideal. That's what we all want. What do you think are some of the contributing factors? And I know you, and I want to say this for everyone, none of you can speak for what's happening in other parts of the world. You can't speak for what churches are doing in Baltimore or Cleveland, right? You can't speak for what a reporter may do in LA or what have you. You can't speak for officers in Ferguson. I get that. That's an unfair expectation. But we have you here for your subject matter expertise in those industries, in those disciplines. But JB, so what do you think, as a police officer of 18 years, drives an officer to adopt that warrior versus guardian mindset?
Some of it's probably training. You know, we in law enforcement for a long time have had that warrior mentality, us versus them, the war on drugs. I mean, that's very much an open policy that's been going on for a long, long time. I'm not a warrior. We are not an invading army. Now, that might be what folks seem. That might be what some people are doing. That's not right. Shouldn't be that way. And so I think it goes back to the fact that it's not about protecting. I am a public servant. And I highlight that word very intentionally. I serve the community. Community doesn't have to provide me anything, but I'm going to ask, what do you need?
And if I can, this kind of, I'm sorry, we're not trying to just put all the attention on you, but
it's okay.
This is in the same area.
Yes.
What steps, specific steps, should a driver take, regardless of race, during a traffic stop that makes you feel at ease, that will make them feel at ease? Just lay it out there.
So what I tell my family is put your hazards on, turn the dome light on if it's at night, pull over, put your hands on the steering wheel, don't move around. A lot of folks try to grab driver's license and do all that kind of thing. The more movement that you do, the less likely I'm going to be to be excited about what you're doing. Don't be surprised if I come up on the right side of your car. Again, I'm not a small fella. Cars tend to find big guys. So I'm going to approach on the right. That has nothing to do with you. That has everything to do with keeping me from being a hood ornament. And so that's what we ask is simply illustrate to me that you have no intentions of hurting me. The first traffic stop I made when I was assigned back to patrol, I made it for a headlight violation. It's something that I like to do, and I apologize. It was at night, ended up being an African-American man, and he had a grip on the steering wheel. And as I asked him for his driver's license, he very plainly said, it's in the center console, can I grab it? I said, yes, sir, and he grabbed it, handed it to me. Can I see your registration? He said, yes, sir, it's in my glove box. He didn't move until he asked me. I finished the traffic stop. And this is the difference in me now than me 18 years ago. 18 years ago, I said, hey, that's awesome, and I'd have let him go. When I got finished, I asked him, I said, is there any way I could have helped you feel better about this traffic stop? And his statement to me was, I was worried about how you felt. He was worried about me. And so I think that's where we are when we talk about traffic stops. It's we both had mutual respect for each other. I knew what he was doing. He was trying to advertise where he was headed. That's something that I wish he didn't have to do. I wish we could get back to the days where we had a nice, easy conversation. But we're not there.
So trust is a big issue in talking to you, JB, but I'm not going to address this one to you, right? Trust is a big issue with law enforcement in the African-American community, in the black community. We heard it time and, I mean, I've watched this three times. I've heard it time and time again. We don't trust the police, was said very loud and clear. Dr. Harshaw, I want to ask you, in the work that you've been doing, how have, if you have, been helping members of the community break down those trust issues and those barriers of trust with law enforcement? What are some of the things that can be done, that you have done or that you think can be done to help break down those trust barriers, whether it's from a community standpoint or from your experience in some things law enforcement maybe could do differently? But I think there is some responsibility on both sides of that equation.
Yes, yes. Well, I think first of all, from faith perspective, it's important to recognize that there is a problem and there is a difficulty, and then to be honest enough to really deal with the details of that, and then to build relationships, and then also to work on some kind of common goal. Those four things, and what we've done at First Baptist Church across the years is that we have had days where we honor law enforcement, and we build relationships with them, and when things happen in the community, it's easy then to be called in or to go to them because we already have these existing relationships. And I think that's really, really important. We had several years where we would just honor and the firefighters and people who worked for the courts as well, so that we could build relationships. And some, you know, I went to the courts to get to know some of the judges and know a lot of the law enforcement officers. And that at least is a way of us understanding each other as human beings and persons. And you know, and by and large, all the professionals are good and they're trying to do a good job, as I am as a pastor. But that relational piece is so important because it provides communication that otherwise would not take place. And then you can kind of give nuances and perspective when you talk with them about a culture that they might not understand. And so the educational piece is an ongoing piece, which means that the dialogue must continue. The sheriff, I saw Sheriff Harrison just recently, and he wants to gather some pastors together to talk in light of what is taking place now in the nation, et cetera. And, but that's based upon a relationship over a period of years. And it seems to me that that's one way to do it. And then also, you know, just dealing with the community. And we have a lot of young people in the church that have received the lecture and et cetera of what to do. And we have brought people in to talk with our young people about how they should respond, and particularly the males, because there, you know, there will be a problem. I had to talk with my son, and he was in the Air Force for 10 years, and he was stationed in Las Vegas. And he was telling me about how he got a car that one of his colleagues got. They had the exact same car, but he was stopped like five times. And he went to the Anglo colleague and said, have you been stopped? And the response was, no, I've not been stopped at all. And it brought him to the awareness. Here he is in leadership in the Air Force, in intelligence. And because he's an African-American young man and he's in a car that looks suspicious, he stopped again and again and again. And so you provide opportunities with your youth group or young people in the church, but also in your own home, to talk about issues that are real.
Thank you. And you talked about young men in the church. And so, Marcus, I'm going to ask you this, and something that is actually going to be reflective on the faith-based community. Do you believe, or what role, if any, do you believe that the faith-based community plays as someone who is out here looking to affect change, doing some things yourself, right? Or how do you look at the faith-based community and the role and responsibility that they have in helping to affect change, if any at all? Are you looking to or leaning on the church, or are you of the mindset, look, man, I ain't rocking with them. I don't trust them just like I don't trust the police. You know, I'm doing my own thing. I mean, you're not, just real talk. Don't worry.
I think the church plays an important role, because when they do after school programming, and when I work with communities that I work with now, it's through the church. And a lot of times you get kids 11 years old that've seen their uncles be shot by police officers. So it's real life, it's real stories. And for them to have a place that everybody come together and meet, I've talked to a 7-year-old who's seen her cousin get pulled over and get beat up by a police officer. So it's definitely a perspective. And if it wasn't for the church being in that neighborhood, they wouldn't have anywhere to go. So I think it plays a big part. But at the same time, I think that the church should definitely start to begin programming with police officers in these after school programs and things of that nature, because you have to break that wall. And children are really impressionable. So you have to let them know, like, hey, this is just JB. He's not just an officer. And once you get past that, you built that trust. So now that kid, that same kid who was just scared of him, he's running to him once his friend gets beat up or something. Like, hey, JB, my friend needs help. So right there, you've just built a line of communication. And that's why kids are so important to the movement. We have to really understand that if you get the kids behind them and the kids behind police officers, it'll only help and affect everyone else as well.
Now, you're a recent graduate of NC State.
Yes, sir.
And I think we have some professors from NC State that may be in the building right now. Do you believe that our institutions of higher learning have a responsibility in helping to bridge this gap, much similar to the church? Or once again, like, no, they just need to educate and leave the advocacy and the activism to those who do that?
I think anybody can create change.
I want, from a responsibility standpoint, are you looking to the institutions of higher learning to say, hey, you guys have a stake in this, you have some responsibility as well, or no? I don't want to put words in your mouth.
Yes and no. I do believe if you're in an institution of higher learning, you should make yourself relevant to the community and make yourself approachable. I don't think you should be at a higher level or high school or middle school even and not talk to kids and let them know, like, you can do this. I think everyone needs a role model. And to see someone at the highest level is no greater good than seeing someone at the highest level. Just like a basketball player seeing Michael Jordan. Oh, now I want to be like Mike. So you have to instill in kids that you can do this and you can be there as me. So definitely, I think it's a responsibility for everybody in a higher institution as well as high school and middle school.
I think we have another question from the audience.
Yeah, we have several. Actually, I'm going to go back to Marcus and Candace if you want to reply as well as a millennial. What kind of conversations do you and your friends have about cops and how to handle situations? Do you see a difference generationally as well?
There's definitely a difference. we're a more accepting generation, I think. We would definitely tweet, text about it real quick, and then next week an app will come out and we'll forget about it. So I definitely think as a generation that's kind of our flaw. We're really short term. So when Philando Castile died, the next week Pokemon Go came out and no one was talking about Philando no more. So we're backing the members and the activists, but we're not sticking with it. So I think as community members, we should definitely try to fight that more often, but I think we have to do better in that terms. We're definitely a short-termed generation, definitely.
You know, I think for me and my friends, the conversation has the potential to become very tense just because of the position that I'm in as a reporter and as the daughter of a police officer. And I have some friends with some very strong opinions who don't hold back, who have opinions about the media. As well as police officers, and so it does have the potential to become very tense, our conversations. But I also give them room to just feel how they feel. You know, I mean, And they know, my friends know what family I come from, what my background is, what I do for a living. I mean, they're my good, close friends, but they're also really quick to be like, oh, those police, they just, you know, they're angry. They feel comfortable expressing their anger to me, and then I feel comfortable, you know, then, you know, maybe giving them a different perspective, but I also understand their anger. So I would say our conversations could become very tense, but they don't, because there's just room to just let people feel how they feel, mm-hmm. You know, just don't, you know, don't say it's, you know, for instance, you know, when Philando Castile or, you know, even I was like, stop telling people when it's time to heal, you know, let them feel how they feel for a little while or for as long as they feel like they need to feel that way. And so I give them that space. I give my friends that room and that space to say, to just be open and honest and real. And I think that that's a positive.
There's one question. Any number of you, I'm sure, could answer it, but I think it's really important because it's a question that if you hear this term, some people just drop the mic and walk out the door as soon as they hear Black Lives Matter. They think they're offended by the term. They don't understand what it means. They typically respond immediately with All Lives Matter. Can someone on the panel explain what Black Lives Matter as a movement is supposed to mean and what perhaps that term, why it originated and what the point was?
I'd be happy to, happy to respond along with any others. And I, you know, of course, people who talk about Black Lives Matter believe also that all lives matter. Mm-hmm. But what they're trying to focus on is, again, the disparity of Black lives in the urban settings and African American communities that are taken so easily over and over and over again, and the pain and the sorrow and the mothers crying and the families torn apart and the incarceration rate, et cetera. And there's just a lot of pain. And until we balance things to make them even, we have to use slogans like that to affirm Black life that is always threatened. But it doesn't mean that then you exclude other lives or you become a racist with that. And I can't speak for the movement. I'm not particularly a part of the movement necessarily. And it really is diverse. However, I know how it started because African-American males were being killed. That's how it started. There was blood in the streets. People died. And so as a result of that, somebody stood up and said, our lives really matter in this community. It's a broken down community. Are there issues here? But yet our lives matter. Our future, our destiny matters. And I think if we keep that in view, then we can deal with the movement as a whole. What it will become, who knows? But that slogan is important, but I would agree and I would say all lives matter. But all lives are not African American. All lives are not former slaves. All lives have not suffered like Black people have in North America. And so unless you understand that, you may not want to hear it, whether you're African American or not. But the issue, that is the truth. And unless we understand that, then we'll never get to the solution of the problems.
Can I see the hands of everyone who's actually been to the Black Lives Matter website? What did you see on that website that was missing? Don't say anything, JB. Those that raised their hand, who, when you looked at the website, what did you see that was missing? No one? Go ahead, JB. Tell them what was missing.
Black fathers.
The slogan does not match the core principles. Okay, I want to be real clear about that. I'm not a Black Lives Matter fan. Not ashamed to say it, I'm not a fan. Go to the website, look at the website, really study the website. Study everything that they stand for, read their core principles. I guarantee you the slogan, now the slogan has taken on
a life of its own. Right.
But at its very core principle, there is an elimination of the Black man when it comes to Black Lives Matter. Let there be no misconceptions about it.
And I think, I'm sorry, and I think that was an evolution, because I do agree that the spirit of the movement, mm-hmm. of what I believe it represents as it's taking off, there's a lot of validity and meaning to that, but from an institution or an entity of how it's evolved and how it's stated, I think there is a movement aspect of it that has a lot of validity and a necessity to it. And you know, I've seen it, so I know exactly what you're talking about. But then that institution of what is represented now and that what's documented on that website is definitely inconsistent with the spirit of the movement right
now.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. Now, let me ask you this, Kate. You were bothered when the conversation took place about Black Lives Matter, right? That's kind of what started your engagement and your kind of the dialogue that led you to doing the work that you're doing.
Yes.
Do you believe that there is fundamentally a difference in how law enforcement treats white people versus Black people? Let me add another way. Are you afraid? Marcus talked about his fear and being scared. Are you scared when the police pull you over?
Well, I think what I would say is nervous and anxious. I think it's normal for folks of any color to feel, and I'm not particularly happy to get a speeding ticket or something like that, you know. But I don't have the same perspective or the same fear for myself. I don't think that I'm treated in the same way I see that I'm not treated in the same way as my children are. Sometimes I'll be in a park and people won't realize that my daughter is my daughter, and they'll say something or they'll presume that she is not being supervised by a parent. Even though I'm sitting 5 feet away. What happened at the block party, when I was having the conversation with the police officer, my point was, what are we doing in our community? Because there seemed to be a lot of folks talking about the Dallas sniper shooting, but no one was talking about the Philando Castile. And what I said to him was, as a parent, what can you say to me to make me feel comfortable about my child being the one pulled over? And he said, well, comply, comply, comply. And I said, did you see the video? Did you watch the video? And it was a lengthy conversation. We had a very, and he said, well, we didn't see what happened before and after, and I didn't see the whole video, this and that and the other. And I said, well, you know, if you watch the video, he is complying, and that's why that recommendation feels hollow to someone in that situation. And it was interesting to me. He said we couldn't jump to any conclusions, but at the end of our conversation, he said, well, even if the officer was wrong, did make a bad choice, we know that it wasn't malicious. And I said, well, sir, you're telling me that we don't have the evidence, we haven't seen the whole video, we don't have all the information. How do you know with certainty that it wasn't malicious? I'm not saying it was, but the problem in that was that he was automatically, without question, just taking the position of the officer in the situation. And that was the catalyst for me to think perhaps we need to be doing more in our community. I don't know that I would feel comfortable if this gentleman 10 years from now was pulling my daughter over, that she would be treated in the same way that I would be treated.
You know, you just talked about, you've seen a difference. You believe there's a difference, right, in how law enforcement officers treat white citizens versus Black citizens, right, or people of color in general. JB, I'm going to throw this back over to you. And I understand you can speak for yourself and your experience and maybe the culture even of your department, of the Cary Police Department. What do you say to someone who says, why do police officers protect and serve white people, but they police Black people? Well, what do you say to that?
I think that might be the problem, is the expectation is that I'm supposed to say something to a community. I think the idea is I'm supposed to listen to a community. I'm supposed to find out what a community needs from me, and I make it work through the services that we provide at the organization. And so I'll always challenge the idea that I'm supposed to say something to someone else. Because absent me doing it, absent me being there, I can't speak to the mentality or the ideas. What I can speak to is, what do you need? How can I serve you? How can we serve you? And then we try to work to make that happen. And I think that takes a shift. It takes the idea that you trust me enough to ask that question. Now, I realize we haven't earned that trust to some degree, but that's where I'm at. I want to know what you need so we can work to make it happen. And so I'll challenge just the basis of the question that I'm responsible to say something to someone. I want to serve you in the ways that you need me to serve you.
So if someone asked you that question directly, though, mm-hmm. So hey, you're a police officer. Hey, man, look. Help me understand, because I want to understand.
Right.
Help me understand, why do y'all, and they're going to say y'all because you're wearing a uniform, right? Why do y'all protect and serve all the white people, but y'all got to police the black people? So someone is asking you that question directly. What do you say to that individual?
I don't know. I don't know why that happens. I don't. I don't have the answer. Okay. Fair enough. I just don't.
Yeah. Fair enough. Slow. So... JB talked about trust, right? And once again, I'm going back to, because I've just spent some time looking at this 21st century policing document. And the six pillars, the very first pillar, and for those who are familiar with it, the very first pillar of President Obama's policy on 21st century policing is trust and legitimacy. That is the very first thing that is should be the focus. And yet that is the biggest issue. What is the relationship in your mind between both trust and legitimacy? How are those two things linked and or even distinct, if you will? And do you feel as though law enforcement provides that? You know, have they won your trust and do you view them as a legitimate entity?
I think it's pockets. I think you have guys like JB, whom we love, admire, and respect. I think there's the trust and legitimacy comes from genuine outreach, genuine bridge building, genuine bringing or bringing closure to the gap and establishing that relationship. It's difficult, man. It's a challenge. With regards to trust, because trust is predicated on familiarity. And if you're not familiar with me and I'm not familiar with you, I can't trust you. And so with more opportunities of guys like JB and local police involvement and enforcement in the area, the more familiar they become with us and the more familiar we become with them, then I think we do bridge that gap, and the trust and the legitimacy of that trust, we begin to bridge that gap. The interesting thing to me is, with regards to my children, is I teach my children to live in this world to be cautious. You know, I want them to be cautious of, I want them to be aware, you know. I think it's important for people to be cautious and aware of one another. The challenge is a white woman who's afraid of me. She needs to be cautious of me simply because I'm a stranger, not because I'm a black stranger. And therein lies the challenge. That white woman, or that white man for that matter, because they're not familiar or have had any type of interaction with someone my skin complexion or my color on a regular basis, then you can't be familiar with me. So there is a heightened level of distrust. And understand what I'm saying. There should be a healthy level of caution and distrust, not a heightened level of caution and distrust predicated on the color of my skin.
Gotcha. So I like that, the familiarity piece. And I think that is missing, right? a lot of law enforcement officers do not take the time to get to know the members of their community. And quite candidly, members of the community do not take the time to get to know the officers that police and serve those communities. And it is a very transactional exchange and relationship, if you will, that needs to evolve some way, somehow, to one that is transformational in nature versus a very just rigid transactional relationship if we're going to get to that place of familiarity, right?
I think we're just as accountable to
the community.
The black community.
The black community.
You know, we want to put it all on the police, and we want to put it all on the police force. But, you know, and I might be in the minority of this, but a lot of it is on us as well. You know, teaching our children right from wrong and being objective when they do wrong. You know, there's a lot of that. And if we're going to be real with each other, we're going to be real with the situation and the circumstance. Let's be real with each other, because we know we got some bad, we got some really bad children. Okay. And so, you know, we got to be honest about it. We know they bad, you know. And so because we know they bad, we got to chastise them accordingly. You know, when Trey acts up, I got to check him. Is that, you know, I'm going to check him. You know what I'm saying? He knows he's going to get checked. But the problem is, when they check him, by the time he checks him, it's too late. He shouldn't have to check him. If I'm doing my job, then he won't get checked. And that's important. We can't miss that point.
Right, and I want to chime in, and I know as a moderator, I'm breaking a little bit of a moderator rule right now, but I do want to chime in and say one of the reasons that I first walked through those doors 3 years ago, the Cary PD, and I agree with you 100%, but I also saw the flip side of that is if, in my perception, right, this was my take on it, if they check a young white kid, right, then it's just like, oh, look, cut that out, don't do that again, you know better. They check Austin, my son, because he's got dark skin, he's going to jail.
Hemmed up.
He's going to jail. And so all, and then it goes back to what you were saying, Kate, all I wanted was just the same truth. I'm not saying that it's wrong to take little, what's a white name?
Jimmy,
thank you. Take little Jimmy and let them go. I'm not saying that's wrong, because I don't want you to throw any kid's life away, right? All I'm saying is extend the same courtesy to my little dude, right?
You know, people and get treated fairly, but not the same.
Right, Kate.
And I just want to add on that. One of the things, I keep talking about this police officer who unknowingly was the catalyst for this project that I'm working on. One of the things I tried to do at that block party was talk to him about what his perspective is and try to understand why he had these feelings that he had and why he was reacting in this way. One of the things he said that was interesting was that he'd encountered black children spitting at him just as, because he was a police officer. He wasn't saying every black child does that, but just, you know, sort of being in a neighborhood and having a child thinking that he was going to have a good interaction and having that child already sort of poisoned about his presence. And this is his perspective, but I thought it was an interesting one, and one I hadn't thought of before. That's why I'm following up on the point that you were making.
That has a lot to do with authority as well. I referee basketball locally here with the high schools and the middle schools, and a lot of, if I'm going to be completely honest about it, a lot of my greater challenges when I'm refereeing basketball, 95% of the most disrespectful players on the court are the black basketball players. Call a foul on a white kid, he hands me the ball, he keeps it moving. Might have an attitude, but he's not going to give me a whole lot of lip. The black basketball player, I got to give mouth. You know, I got to get service from him. You know what I'm saying? I'm not trying to hear all of that. And so a lot of it comes from that. And I think a lot of the responsibility, we need to be accountable.
So there's a level of accountability that we need to take on as members of the black community while still holding the members of law enforcement accountable for the way that any time that they are acting inappropriately. And it goes back to a point that you touched on before, Slow, about that familiarity and that relationship. Because I believe in my experience in doing this and talking to people and in my own interactions, it's so challenging to hold someone accountable that you are not in a relationship.
It's difficult.
With.
It's very right? difficult.
So if there's a young kid, I see a young black male walking down the street, have his pants hanging halfway down, and I'm going over to that young brother, yo, man, pull your pants up. If I don't have a relationship with him, I don't know him, he looking at me like, yo, OG, who is you? Right? But if I have a relationship with that young man, I say, oh, hey, Mr. True, yeah, okay, no problem. Now he might pull him down again when he get around the corner, but because there is a relationship there, and the same with law enforcement, I believe that unless we can effectively build relationships with the members of our law enforcement, it is going to be virtually impossible to hold them accountable, right? Now, we wanted to talk about some of the ways that we can provide solutions and some of the causes of the problems that we're having. And I want to understand do you believe that, and I want to ask this question for all of you, so law enforcement, and you touched on it already, Slow, community, right? There's some things we need to do as a black community, right? We need to do better. Yeah, yeah, please.
With all of these. Two things. First of all, there was one question that I think was along those lines. You talked about the young man with his pants down or the young men who were talking back to you on the basketball court. Someone asked a question, but what about me? I'm in a suit. I'm a black man, and I still get pulled over, and I'm still disrespected. What's the reason behind that?
See, I think professional policing is professional regardless of who gets stopped. Doesn't matter if the person is wearing gym clothes or they're wearing a suit. Professional policing is professional policing, and so even if someone's got a history, that's history. I'm dealing with you right here. I have to be professional. That's my duty. Our chief likes to say the phrase, "There's one person in that relationship being paid to be professional. That's me," and so I'm less concerned about who that person is or what they're wearing, and I'm more concerned about the behaviors that are being exhibited right here in front of me. And I think that's what professional policing looks like.
So essentially you're saying it shouldn't happen to whoever asked that question. That should not be happening to you, you know, because regardless of whether you're in your gym clothes, hat backwards, or you're in your suit, you shouldn't be getting pulled over just because you're black.
That's correct.
Regardless.
Yes.
They shouldn't have to require you to dress up just to not have to get pulled over.
Right.
Now, I have a follow-up on that, but we have a great question I want to get to, but I do have a follow-up on that.
It's in line with a few comments back, but I still think it's important. The headline is No Balance in Charges. I'll give this to Kate, the lady in blue. Police officers not being charged in killings. What things are the courts doing to help the community feel better about the scales of justice being balanced? So accountability again, what have you seen just as an attorney as well?
Sure.
In justice not being balanced?
Sure. Well, I think that moving towards greater transparency is one way for courts and police officers and district attorneys and judges to make communities feel more comfortable with the decisions they're making with regard to who's being charged, how the case procedurally is moving forward. And what I mean by that is sometimes I think there can be a correlation, and True and I have talked about this before, and actually Adrian and I had a good conversation about this, where you see a correlation between rioting and distrust and community members being angered and upset, rightfully so, a correlation between police not revealing videotape or revealing evidence that they have that is the basis for the decision making. So I think moving forward and being more transparent, it can be tricky, I think, when you're dealing with criminal charges and prosecuting cases. Sometimes there are constraints with regard to what information can be made public. So I think that can be, when you're starting at a place that where there is distrust, and then you have information that's being withheld that may be the basis for the decision for someone to be charged or not to be charged. I think that communities moving towards greater transparency can be helpful with alleviating some of those problems.
Okay, and so thank you, Kate. Mm-hmm. And I want to get to the follow-up question that I had for you, JB, in talking about, you know, it shouldn't happen, right? So, and I'm going to come back to you, Doctor. It's happening because there are some bad apples out there, right? And that's my take on it, right? So I don't want to make that an absolute. I believe it's happening because there are some bad apples out there that are acting out on their biases, their prejudice, and what have you, right? Right? Fear. So for those bad apples out there, this question has come up over the years in doing this. Why aren't the good apples, such as yourself, right? Good apple, right?
Thank you.
Why aren't the good apples doing more to rid their departments of the bad apples so that you're not now being painted with that same broad brush that the community is painting law enforcement with based on our experiences with law enforcement?
I think that goes down to, if you believe an officer to be professional, an unprofessional officer knows that officer's professional. They're not inclined to hang out with that professional police officer. That's not how that relationship works. They don't want to be in front of that professional police officer doing those unprofessional things because the professional police officer is going to turn them in because they know that's not what we do in this organization. And so I think you have this idea of unprofessional police officers tend to find and gravitate towards others who might allow that. Well, then they're unprofessional too. Now, there's another conversation to this. Some of these conversations that we're having, some of these incidences, are officers making mistakes, honest mistakes. There are some legitimately bad apples, but I think there are some cases where there are some mistakes made. It doesn't mean those officers shouldn't be held accountable, but that's a far cry from dirty officers. But I do ultimately believe that the unprofessional officers don't want to be around the professional officers, and so the professional officer never has an opportunity to turn that officer in.
Please, Candace.
He talks about professional and unprofessional officers, and sometimes it's just not that blatant and it's just not that easy to spot. And so you say, why don't the good officers do more to help weed out the bad apples? You know, you may have a partner who won't necessarily steal from a crime scene or bust somebody in the back of the head for no reason, but he may have some ideals and bring some implicit biases that you know aren't right, or they don't jive. So do you go to your superior and say, well, I think there's you can go to your superior and say, I saw him stealing, I saw him, you know, bust somebody up for no reason. It's hard to go to your superior and say, I think this officer is dealing with some racism or some prejudice, and how do you document that? But I will say that, you know, for my mother, she's had conversations with some partners that are tough to have, where they disagree on how they approach, you know, certain communities, and so you never know what conversations are being had in those squad cars, you know, for the 8 or so hours that two officers are together. And I think that it's sort of a fine line between the blatant and the obvious, and the something's not quite right about my partner, but is this an opportunity to educate him and have a conversation with him, or do I need to go to somebody and talk to somebody about this person and this problem?
Have you ever had to turn in a bad officer, JD?
No. Not in 18 years. No. We've had corrections of behaviors that weren't bad officer. It was that officer who made the wrong decision, or that officer who did wrong or didn't do what he legally could do. But that's why I had to think about it, because it's not bad. It's an officer needed training or needed correction.
So want to talk about what are some things that are being done or that you can do from a solution standpoint as an individual, as a community member, as a citizen, and as a leader in your respective discipline, right? But I wanna take a different approach to that and ask you, are there some things that you think your group, institution, entity is doing that may possibly be contributing to the problem? Are there some things that you think the church as a whole has done that may have contributed to the problem that we're facing?
Yeah, well, I wonder if I could just respond. First of all, I think there are two things that need to be emphasized in terms of the whole approach to policing. And one is the attitude or the mentality and training. Because if you train officers to be a military force and a certain community to be the enemy territory, you're going to always have problems. And it seems to me that you know, that ongoing dialogue and how people are processed and oriented into the work that they do is really part of the critical problem. So when you let young rookies go and they think they're on the battlefield because it's an area where there are certain kinds of people living, you have to fight against that or retrain or talk about that. Otherwise, they're going to suit up and they're in war. And in some cases, the work is war, I know. But sometimes the war is relative or connected to a race of people. That's the problem. But again, in terms of the faith community, there's a lot of work that needs to be done in dialogue and looking at the great divide that we see in the faith community today, but also coming to common goals to work on things that we can measure and assess and not just talk about it. And so the engagement of that, I think, is the only solution, you know.
Got you. Yeah, kind of that divide. We talk about the black church and then the white church. So there's there's a problem right there, divisiveness just even within the body, mm-hmm. right? And so how does that manifest itself in the teachings and the learnings and the conditioning and, you know, the social learning that we are bringing our congregants up in, right. you know, and then introducing them into society and never really helping them understand how to effectively integrate and be inclusive mm-hmm. in which is really the way that Christ intended it to be. But we're not practicing that in our.
Yeah, right. And how do you live with diversity? I mean,
Things who we should be teaching in the church.
Right. Yeah. Difference in community. I mean, that's part of who Jesus Christ is and was, and that's what he tried to teach his disciples. There was one occasion where they were hanging out with Jesus in a way of speaking, and they saw some other disciples, and they pointed to them and said, well, Jesus, they're not with us. He said, let them alone. Just let them do their thing. They don't all need to be following me. And so it means that people can exist in different ways in the faith community, but yet still fight for a common cause.
Yeah. Yeah. No, absolutely. Candace, I'll jump to you from a media standpoint, right? So I think this particular event, and I applaud WRAL for putting this on, I think this is something very positive to be a part of the solution. So thank you, and thank you all for members of WRAL. Are there some things you mentioned earlier, your friends, and you say, the media. is that how you did that, do it right? So what type of feedback do you get from doing this? I've heard a lot of people share their thoughts on the role the media plays as a contributor to what we're talking about. What type of feedback do you get from your friends, and what type of response do you offer to them as to the accusations that you may hear about the role of the media in contributing to these issues?
I think it goes back to the whole trust thing that you were talking about. I mean, I think that a lot of people just quite honestly, just have an issue trusting us and trusting our motives and, you know, what's the angle. And one of the things that I think that we could do better is, you know, just, I think, not treating a story just like it's a story. And to always remember that you know, these are people that we're dealing with, and I applaud Ms. Bird for being here. And, you know, but I think about us, you know, talking about her son and everything that's transpired there. And I don't know how many reporters she's been in contact with over the last several weeks and months. And, you know, I don't think it's probably the same face consistently. And so I think sometimes it can kind of just paint the picture that we're just in and then out and then in and then out and then we're rotating and then we're handing off and it's just the story and we got to get it on. And certainly there are deadlines and there are things that we need to do to put on a product. But if she were able to be familiar with a reporter and be able to trust us, you know, that to me, that goes a long way. And I just think that it's trust. I mean, I just think a lot of times people just, you're here and then you need the interview or you need the get, you need that emotion, you need that thing that's gonna grab people's attention, and then you're gone, and then where are you? And then you don't call, and then you don't follow up, and then oh, the next time, you know, we have a follow up on the story and the person's in court, and then here you are again, you know, needing the story. So I think we could do a better job of building trust and relationships.
Okay. Do you believe, as a coach, you have some way, somehow, contributed to the problem with some of the, contributed to the problem with some of the lessons that you've shared or some of the things that you've said to your young men? Or do you even think this is an area of responsibility for you as a coach to address with your young men? Or is it just about getting that next W?
When I started coaching in semi-pro football, it was completely by accident. And when it was about 5 or 6 years ago, when I got started and I got involved, I just began to see a trend. The majority of the guys who were playing, if I'm going to be completely honest, didn't have a pot to piss in and a window to throw it out. And so I began to realize that there was an opportunity here for me to reach out to these guys and help them reestablish themselves and become productive, contributing members to our society and our community. And that wasn't my intent. My intent was, I just love the game. I like to cuss. I want to go out there and tell people what to do. I like to order people around. I like to delegate. It's what I do. And then it evolved, you know, and then it evolved. And it's just, hey, that's just me. If you know me, then you know that's how I am. And I'm going to tell you anything. I'm going to tell you the truth. And so one of the challenge that I have is, and I know I'm in the minority on this, you know, life really is about decision making. And we're defined by our decisions. And far too often, the young men that I was coaching or the young men that I had charge of, I just found them making more and more and more and more poor decisions. And it was this repetitive thing where they just refused to make the right decisions. And it was baffling to me, it was challenging to me, you know? And so it is a difficult thing when you've not had someone to really contribute to your life and explain to you the importance of not doing this. Because you grow up in a world where you don't have a healthy amount of fear with regards to consequences. And so when you grow up in a world where you have no fear of consequences, you'll do whatever the hell you want to, whenever the hell you want to. And that's the challenge. The challenge is helping these young black men understand the consequences of their decisions and their actions. What are the ramifications? What are the results? This is what's going to happen. You have to care about that. You have to care about that result. You know what I'm saying? So that to me is the challenge, and that's what I have charged myself with. I've charged myself with, hey man, look, this is what's gonna happen if you beat your girlfriend up. This is what's gonna happen if you get high and you start driving. You know, this is what's gonna happen when you're drinking and, you know, you'd get in that car and you do such and such, you know. So, you know, it's just, you know, it's a matter of trying to teach them the consequences of their actions and the ramifications and ensure that at some point down the line, because let's face it, it takes some of us a little bit longer. We got to get beat over the head a couple more times than others before we get it right. But we can't give up on them. You know, Truth straightened up a whole lot sooner than I did.
No, that's awesome, man. So it's evolved from trying to win games to trying to save lives, essentially.
Absolutely.
You know, not just coaching, but mentoring. No, that's powerful. We're going to take one more question from the audience, and then we're going to wrap this thing up.
I actually had about two more.
Okay, then we're going to take two more questions from the audience before we wrap this thing up.
Good questions. Something just along the lines of what Slo just said, talking about, you know, the conversations that you have with African-American men. But I think, you know, the question is, what about the miscarriage of justice? What about the young white men who are just as reckless, just as irresponsible, doing whatever they want? What did you say?
Whatever the hell they want, whenever they want.
Whatever, I can't curse. Yeah, my boss is here, I can't curse, but whatever. But and they don't have the same consequences. They don't face the same penalties either with the law or with another entity. What do you say to that? Because that seems to be the foundation of this argument. And someone actually gave an example talking about, I don't know if you all remember, the Stanford swimmer who was convicted of rape and spent a month in jail, convicted of first degree rape and spent a month in jail. And a black man who may be selling drugs, maybe it was his first time, this is the question, and they're spending at least a decade behind bars. When you see those types of differences in justice, JB2, how do you explain that?
Yeah, I think that goes to the systems that we're talking about. My belief is that we change those systems that we're currently in from within. I understand that's my position of privilege, but that's where we are. So we change those systems from within, and then once we have the change requisite, we change it wholesale from the outside. And so there is no explanation for a first-degree rapist to get a month. There's not one. It just doesn't exist. And so when we talk about, I've mentioned the war on drugs before, when we talk about that if you have cocaine in rock form, you're treated differently than if you have cocaine in powder form. That's unfortunately not a law enforcement issue in the sense that I can't make that change. Voters make that change to their elected officials. And so this is where we begin to talk about systems and how mental health systems come into play and education systems come into play and all of those systems that are outside the scope of law enforcement. And yet we, as the visible first arm of government, have to address it and deal with it.
No, thank you, JB. Did that answer the question? Well, thank you all. I mean, let's give our panelists a round of applause. Thank you all. Thank you all. And all of you, thank you all. And once again, Ms. Byrd, a special acknowledgement and shout out to you. Thank you very much for being here and for joining us. Steve, Jim, Mimi, I want to thank you for allowing me to partner with you on this effort, this initiative. This is very important work, and I commend you. And one more palm collision, one more time for WRAL, if you guys don't mind. What I would like to see as we have this conversation is those of you who are in different disciplines, because that's what it's going to take, because it is a huge problem that's not going to get solved overnight, but all of you are here for a reason, because you believe that the change can take place, right? And so the contributions to the problem are going to need to be the same institutions and entities that are going to be part of the solution. We need leaders from our faith-based community. We need leaders from our financial institutions. We need leaders that are in the lawmaking positions. We need leaders that are in law enforcement positions. We need leaders that are in education. We need community leaders. We need parents. We need people, leaders in media, all to come together to lend our areas of expertise, our gifts and our talents, our passions and convictions, to take a long, hard look at things that we can do to come together to solve these problems, and really take a long, hard look at the things that we are doing in our respective lives, institutions, and entities that are contributing to the problem. Because we're seeing it play out between law enforcement and the black community, but that's not where it begins. That's just where we're seeing it play out. The way that we're educating our young people or lack thereof, the sense of hopelessness that's being created by our financial institutions in providing opportunities, the messages that are being portrayed that are
allowing people to view different groups of people a certain way through social media and media channels and properties. All of these things are contributing to the issues. And I'll close with this, and I want to give some props to Sergeant Carey for planting this seed in my head when we talked about training. You talked about training in the church, you talked about training in law enforcement. And I remember him saying to me, "True, we do training out the wazoo." I don't think that's not a cuss word, is it? No, okay. He said, "True, we do training out the wazoo." He said, "But after a certain point, it's not a training issue. It's a heart condition." Right? So I'll just leave us all with these words, and I'll just borrow these words from, it was either Steve Harvey or it was Proverbs 4:23. You guys can let me know. Above all things, guard your heart, because it's the things of the heart that will determine the course of your lives. So we cannot allow our hearts to be consumed with fear, hate, anger, disappointment, distrust, no more than we can allow our hearts to be consumed with arrogance, pride, or privilege, because those are the things that will determine the course of our lives, and those are the things that will cause more and more problems and issues regardless. So it's a heart condition. So let's get our hearts right and really understand that if we all get in alignment with our assignment, because we're here for a reason, right? Our focus here on this earth is to contribute. Too often we get caught up in what can I get out of life? What can I get? What can I get? What can I get? The real focus, the reason that we are here, the purpose that each and every one of us exists, is to focus on what can I contribute. Thank you all for being here.